Good morning. It's good to have everyone here. Hopefully you've all had a good weekend so far. Enjoyed this past week in the Lord. He's helped you make it through. And we're gathered again this morning in church to worship Him, to praise Him, and to learn more about Him. Amen. Amen. All right. I just want to get a few announcements out of the way here. Everybody know what tomorrow is? Men? Men? While that is true in a literal sense, tomorrow is Valentine's Day. So please make an effort to reach out to not just your normal loved ones, but reach out to maybe someone who hasn't been to church in a while, maybe a neighbor, a co-worker, and just let them know you love them and you're praying for them and that God loves them. Amen? Amen. All right. Just two announcements this morning. February 17th, ladies' meeting. That will be at Steve and Robbie's house at 7 p.m. Did I? Okay, the theme is love. I was kind of thinking that, you know, I was 17th, 14th of February. So, okay, all right. So the theme is going to be love, ladies. So February 17th, 7 p.m. at Robbie and Steve's. The theme is love. If you have any more questions, please check with Didi, and she will give you more details. All right, and February 26th, what's going on that day? Everybody remember? Love your church. Amen. Love your church day. And we have the fun and fellowship for the evening service starting at 4:30. Okay. Again, bring a covered dish and a trinket or a little token, both. That remind you or say something about your own Christian heritage, your Christian past, okay? Something that might have touched you or meant something to you from youth group or when you were a Sunday school teacher or just attending church. And then maybe a dessert or a main dish or a side dish that you remember that you really like, or maybe something you make on a regular basis for fellowships that people really enjoy. Bring those along. There will be some games and lots of fun. Any additional details, Robbie, on our fellowship for the 26th? Amen. All right. How's our sign-up sheet looking? Okay. Okay, so please see Robbie about that. Get signed up maybe after church or this evening. But the sign-up sheet is out in the foyer. If you have any questions, again, please see Robbie about that. Any other announcements? Okay. Ladies board, if you can meet up here on the right side of the church with Didi. All right. Beth? Okay. Next month. Okay, so please get with Beth about signing up for greeters for next month. All right, and she has a calendar for that, and she will get you down there. All right. Anyone else? All right, Brother David. All right, let's get our praise and worship.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, I know we can do better than that. Good morning. That sounds wonderful. We're all ready to worship the Lord this morning. We're returning to page 88 to start with Such Love. That God should love a sinner such as I, should yearn to change my sorrow into bliss, nor rest till He had planned to bring me nigh. How wonderful is love like this! Such love, such wondrous love, such love, such wondrous love, that God should love a sinner such as I. How wonderful is love like this! That Christ should join so freely in the scheme, although it meant His death on Calvary. Did ever human tongue find lower theme than love divine that ransomed me? Such love, such wondrous love, such love, such wondrous love, that God should love a sinner such as I. How wonderful is love like this, that for a willful outcast such as I, the Father bled, the Savior bled and died, redemption for a worthless slave to buy, who long and long in grace divine. Such love, such wondrous love, such love, such wondrous love, that God should love a sinner such as I. How wonderful is love like this! And now He takes me to His sardis Son. He asked me not to fill a servant's place. The far off country wanderings now are done. Wide open are the arms of grace. Such love, such wondrous love, such love, such wondrous love, that God should love a sinner such as I. How wonderful is love like this! Amen. We'll be turning over to page 601, Constantly Abiding, page number 601. There's a peace in my heart that the world never gave, a peace it cannot take away. Though the trials of life may surround like a cloud, I have a peace that has come here to stay. Abiding, Jesus is mine. Constantly dividing, rapture divine. He never leaves me lonely, whispers oh so kind. I will never leave thee, Jesus is mine. All the world seemed to see of a Savior and King, when peace sweetly came to my heart. Trouble all fled away, and my night turned to day. Blessed Jesus,
Amazing Grace.
I want
about that verse as we sing that first verse one more time. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. When I picked these three songs, I just thought they all sang about that amazing grace in their own way, of how God stepped into our lives sometimes when we least expected it in most amazing ways. And He showed us grace to someone we didn't deserve it. There's no way we could have deserved it, but He still showed us amazing grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Praise God, 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 praise God. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun,
grace is amazing, isn't it? I was thinking of, I believe it's the fourth verse. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. What a promise that it's not just through what we've been through, but as the rest of that verse says, His grace will lead us home. He's not going to leave us nor forsake us. Desire to serve Him and to follow Him, that grace will just continue abounding and giving us what we need to make it through each trial, each temptation, each burden that we carry. It's a never-ending supply from our Father in heaven. Amen. Praise the Lord. We could all be standing as we go united in prayer this morning. We do need to continue to remember the prayer chain requests that have gone out, several of them this week, several that still need prayer from the past. We do need to continue to remember those who have lost loved ones recently, continue to pray for them, their family members, friends, all those affected. Pray for God to work out the situations with insurance and accounts and all the things that go along with that. It's a lot. It's a lot to take on top of the grieving. So just please continue to be in prayer for these families. Pray for our nation. Pray for our leaders at each and every level. This is an election year, and we need to pray that God will give us good, godly, God-fearing leaders. Amen? We need to put people of righteousness in positions of influence so that we can do His will. Need to remember Pastor Tim as he brings the message this morning. Need to pray that God will get the message across to us. Pray for each and every one of us in here that we will receive His word as He intends it for us. Unsaved loved ones, family and friends, by the uplifted hands. Amen. unspoken burdens. Continue to be faithful in prayer. I promise He will answer. Any special spoken requests right before we go to prayer this morning? to be bringing us our song special.
Yellow? Ah, yellow. Yellow. Mom, you got something? You look like you had something.
Taking Elsie home, and lo and behold, he came into a deer, and the deer got me in my Mustang on the way home, and decided he was going to mash up my car. So I wanted to praise the Lord, not for my mashed up car, but for protecting me and Elsie and Diane. You know, cars are replaceable, but I was thinking later, you know, I have this surgery coming up this week, and that could have been a whole nasty thing, and it could have messed up this not happening, because I've been waiting a year for this to happen. And I have, in case you didn't know, I have a convertible. So I've been in several deer accidents with my husband where the car's been totaled every time, and I'm thinking, you know, that deer could have landed on my top, and we wouldn't be here to talk to you about it. But he protected every aspect of that, except for my vehicle. And I'm okay with that. We didn't feel anything. Nothing, no jerk, no nothing. I slowed down a little bit so to check on Elsie first, you know, because she was the elderly lady in the car. And then I ask about Diane. Neither one of them saw the crazy guy, or lady. I believe she was a lady, coming, because she hesitated. And then she decided to, you know, just come on flying across. And I got her good, I think, because I didn't see her in my rearview mirror. And I didn't stop. I didn't know I was supposed to stop. I just kept going because I wanted to make sure the car got home. So I just want to thank him for our safety, and then I'm here to tell you about it today, and all three of us are here, because God, even in the bad, God is there, and his hand is upon us, and I love him and thank him for that
today. How many of you love the Lord this morning? Can I have you clap with me? Don't be so dull. Be happy. We're excited. Here we go. I love this song. What a testimony.
Oh, oh.
I was taking a trip on a plane the other day, just wishing that I could get out. When the man next to me saw the book in my hand and asked me what it was about. So I settled back in my seat, a bestseller, I said, a history and mystery in one. Then I opened up the book and began to read from Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. He was born of a virgin one holy night in the little town of Bethlehem. angels gathered round him underneath the stars, singing praises to the great I Am. He walked on the water, he healed the lame and made the blind to see again. And for the first time here on earth, we learned that God could be a friend. And though he never ever did a single thing wrong, the angry crowd chose him. Then he walked down a road and died on a cross. That was the end of the beginning.
Here, let me help you. Ready? One, clap.
One.
That's not a new book, that's the Bible, he said, and I've heard it all before. I've tried religion, it's shame and guilt, and I don't need it anymore. It's superstition, made up tales, just to help the weak to survive. Let me read it again, I said, but listen closely. This is gonna change your life. He was born of a virgin one holy night in the little town of Bethlehem. Angels gathered round him underneath the stars, singing praises to the great I Am. He walked on the water, he healed the lame and made the blind to see again. And for the first time here on earth, we learned that God could be a friend. And though he never ever did a single thing wrong, the angry crowd chose him. Then he walked down the road and he died on the cross. That was the end of the beginning. The end of the beginning, he said with a smile. What more could there be? He's dead. You said they hung him, put nails in his hands, a crown of thorns on his head. I said I'll read it again, but this time there's more. I believe that this is true. His death wasn't the end, but the beginning of life that's completed in you. Don't you see? He did all this for you. He was born of a virgin one holy night in the little town of Bethlehem. All the angels singing praise to the great I Am. He walked on the water, he healed the lame, made the blind to see.
For the first time here on earth,
did you know that God could be a friend? And though he never ever did a single thing wrong, he was the one the crowd chose. And he walked and he died, but 3 days later, you see, he came and he lived and he died. That was the end of the beginning.
Amen. Thank you, Aaron. Appreciated that. I do like that song. I'll tell you what, when I was sitting up here, by the way, children, you've got a junior church to go to. So go ahead and go back there, and we've got some leaders that are ready to give them a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful message. But as Aaron was singing, I don't know about you, but I think these speakers were really going to it. Because I was right at the end when that bass was going boom, boom, boom. My back was going boom, boom, boom because I felt it in my chair. But it was very, very good. Thank you, Aaron, for encouraging us with that song. Praise the Lord. That was not the end, my friends. That was the beginning. Aaron and I went on a conference yesterday down to Georgia. Wow. Friday and Saturday. 9 hours one way, 9 hours back. So if I fall up here, one of you will get up here and help me back up so and hold me up like Moses so that I can continue preaching. But it was really good. It was a church down there that doing things different than what we do. And Aaron and I were talking on the way back, and we were saying, you know, can we do something that would encourage our church and would help our church? And I think that there are things that we can begin to use that will help you. Because I believe that it is in our best interest to, like what we've been talking about, to be all in for God. If you are all in for God, if you are taking the steps to really be close to God as much as you can, I believe that God is going to bless you. God is going to bless you. And not only is He going to bless you, He's going to help you. Because life is life, my friends. And by the way, I have to tell my wife, if it was a male deer, he would have stopped because he saw her coming. But them females, they just go all over the place. Life happens. Life happens. But I'm here to tell you, praise the Lord, that when we are in it for God, God gives us not only blessings, but He gives us strength in the journey. Trials come and trials go, but we can be victorious. Can you believe that? Can you believe that you can be a victorious Christian? I say amen. I say amen. I want to be a victorious Christian. I want to live for God so that when people look at me, they say, wow, that's a great life. Man, I want to live like that. Man, I want to have that faith. Man, I want to have those blessings in my life. Man, I'd love it if I could have that feeling that they have when they are worshiping God. I would love that. My friends, it's possible for you to have that kind of life. It is possible. But we have to be faithful to what God's Word says. And so we're going to look into the Scriptures. We're going to look at Luke chapter 6, verses 36 through 38. And today we're going to be talking about giving and living better. Giving and living better. And don't think you know what the Scripture's about. Okay? Don't always already put your earphones on and say, Pastor's going to be talking about tithing today. You don't know what I'm going to be talking about. Bless your pointed ears. Get on up. Everybody stand up. Let's read the Word of God. Luke chapter 6, verses 36 through 38. Be ye therefore merciful as your Father also is merciful. Judge not, and ye shall not be judged. And condemn not, and ye shall not be condemned. Forgive, and ye shall be forgiven. Give, and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men give unto your bosom. For with the same measure that ye meet withal, it shall be measured to you again. If you don't understand it, don't worry. We're going to dissect it for you. But the key is, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Let us bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we come to you today wanting your Spirit to move within us. Help us, Lord, as we have been looking to be with you and to have you in our lives and to understand the forgiveness that you give and the forgiveness that we can then give others. To live according to your Word, to serve like you served. And today, Lord, we want to learn how to give and to live better. And so we pray, Lord, that your will would be done in our lives. Open up our hearts. Open up our hearts so we might be able to sense your Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. You may be seated. Give and live better. I know that there are a lot of people that think that this Scripture is all about giving. In fact, there are many preachers that will use this Scripture and say, if you give to God or if you give to my ministry, It will be given back to you. Good measure, pressed down together, shaken over, running over. It will overflow your banks. But God wants more than your money. Thank you. I guess there's only one person that gives. Thank you. Thank you. There we go. We're starting to get the ball rolling. God wants more than your money, my friends. God wants you to have a spirit within you that is a giving spirit. One that wants to give. One that wants to share. One that wants to help. One that wants to care. One that wants to be there so that they can be the example, just like Jesus was the example in giving. So then we can give like Jesus, so the world does not understand how we live. Missy just is passing out the receipts for last year, those of you that gave money for the church. By the way, thank you if you are supporting your church. This is your church. You need to take care of it. We need to have lights on so that we can see. We need to have heat on so that we're not shaking or air conditioning in the summer. So we thank you for that. But as you look at that, you may say, wow, I didn't give very much last year, did I? Or, wow, praise the Lord, God blessed me. Whatever it is, my friends, you can learn from what you've done in the past so that you can do better, or you can do just as good as what you were doing. God wants us to be a giving people. John Wesley said this, do all the good you can, by all the means that you can, in every way that you can, in all the places that you can, at all the times that you can, to all the people that you can, as long as ever you can. Do good as much as you can. Do good as much as you can. It takes more than just saying, I want to be a good person. I know most of you. I believe that most of you are good people. I look at your lives and I see that you are people that want to be upstanding citizens. Most of you are trying to do your best. Unless you're driving. And some of you still struggle with that. Just think what you could do with that $180 ticket. Instead of getting that, you could get on time to church and praise God and give it in tithe. Oh, pastor. There was a man, young man who had just gotten saved, and he was on fire for God, and he wanted to do his very best for God. So he sat down after church one Sunday, and he began to write all the things that he could do for God. He began to think of all the ministries that God could have him do. He wrote down all the list of places that he could go. He listed some of the things that he had to give up so that he would be on fire for God. And the next Sunday, he went down to the altar at altar time, and he laid that sheet of paper down, and when he laid it down and he was praying, he didn't feel any different. So he got back up, went back home, and extended his list. Added more things that he wasn't going to do anymore. Added more places to where he was going to go and serve. Jotted down other ministries that he hadn't thought about before. And the next Sunday he went up and he laid it down again. He signed his name on the paper and he laid it down again and said, here, God, I am giving you all of this and nothing. So he got up from the altar discouraged, thinking that he was trying to do his best. He didn't understand. Went to the pastor. And the pastor says, you're doing it all wrong. He said, here. And he gave him a blank piece of paper. And he said, sign it. And put it on the altar. And as soon as he put that paper on the altar, the glory of God came down. Because he had given everything to God. So many times all we want to do is we want to give God the bits and pieces of our lives. We want to give them the little corners. We want to sometimes give them a closet. Maybe even we go as big to give them a bedroom or a bathroom or a kitchen. When God says, I don't want just part of your house. I want all of your house. I want you to serve me with all that you have. So how do we begin to understand what giving is all about? There are four things that we want to look at today. The first one is this. How do we give? The first way, we give secretly. Secretly. Matthew chapter 6 verses 3 and 4 says this, but when thou doest alms, let not thy left hand know what thy right hand doeth, that thine alms may be in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret himself shall reward thee openly. In the movie Facing the Giants, the coach of the football team who one of his star players had moved away, and so they were thinking it was going to be a good year, 500 at least. And all at once, this player moves away, and so this coach gets really discouraged. And he goes out and he begins to pray and ask God and try to seek God's face, and all at once God says, you've got to leave stuff over to me. So he said, okay, God, it's yours. I'm tired of fighting. I'm tired of losing. Everybody was talking about how he was a terrible coach. People were talking behind his back. So he went to his players and he says, players, he said, I'll tell you this right now. We've been doing it all wrong. We've been thinking that this is all about us. This is not all about us. When you play for the glory of God. When you give your best for the glory of God. When things are going bad, you get down and you try harder for the glory of God. He said, if you start doing this in your lives will change and God will begin to help you and to strengthen you. Some of the players took it to heart. They begin to talk about it and pray about it. And what would it look like? Imagine, what would it look like if our schools, if the teenagers would get behind and begin to pray and say, God, we want your will in our lives. When our workplaces would begin to have Bible studies in the lunchroom instead of playing euchre in the lunchroom. Amen, Pastor. Now you're preaching. All at once, one afternoon, before football practice, but after school, one of the coaches come in and says, Coach, you got to see this. Says, what? He goes, there are players and people that are out in the middle of the football field, and they're just sitting down. I said, what are they doing out there? It's not time for practice yet. Said, no, they're having Bible studies. He goes out and just little groups praying for each other, trying to encourage one another. He begins to shake his head and say, wow. One of the gentlemen who did not, he felt like it was the young men, one of the young men, felt like it was okay, but He had a really bad attitude with his father because his father was very overbearing. And one day after practice, this young man was talking back to his dad. Coach didn't say anything in front of him. But the next day he said, you know, I saw you with the way you talked to your father. He said, you disrespected him. That's not what God wants in your life. God wants you to be better. He said, Coach, you're right. Can you drive me downtown? You know, when God begins to work in your life, you don't want to wait to take care of it. When God begins to work in your life, you're saying, man, I really need to take care of this now. I don't want anything to come in between me and God. And so he took him down to the car dealership where his dad was one of the chief people in the car dealership. And his dad was in a meeting. He said, I got to see my dad, to the secretary. She said, I'll see if you can. And his dad said, what? Why is he here? He shouldn't be here. Did you tell him I was to meet? He said, it was really important. And he walks in and he says, Dad, I want to tell you I'm sorry for the way I acted. And I ask if you forgive me. And his dad is in shock. He leaves. The man who was in the business meeting, I'm getting overwhelmed now, folks. Stay with me. Man who's in the business meeting, man, I wish I had a son like that. People are amazed when you begin to give God what exactly he needs. Say, Pastor Tim, what does this have to do with gifts secretly? Nothing you've said so far has been done in secret. The father sees the change in the son. And so he goes to his son. He says, I've got something you need to do. He said, follow me down to the dealership. They picked out a brand new truck. And they drove it back to the football field where they were having practice. The son and the father are looking on behind the bushes. And the coach, who has a beater truck, you know what a beater truck is? It's the kind of trucks we drive, right? Everybody knows that. And he begins to weep openly. He said, what? Note in it says it's yours. Thank you. Do you know who did this? Did you see anybody? I didn't see anybody, coach. This is somebody else he's talking to. Father and the son are over in the corner. And the father looks at his son and says, don't say a word to anybody. Can I tell you, when you give things in secret, when you give God praise by your life and it's done in secret, God is going to reward you with blessings you can't even imagine. If you want to get up in front of the Sunday morning crowd and say, I'm going to give $2,000, well, praise the Lord, you just got your blessing there when everybody says, oh, wow, that's wonderful. But when you don't tell a soul and you give praise to God by doing something, being caring, helping, encouraging, giving money, giving time, your reward is not here yet. But it will be coming. Give secretly. The second thing we need to do is give generously. Give generously. Acts chapter 3 and verse 6 talks us about a story that Peter and John are going into the temple. And as they're going in, there's this lame man that's sitting on the right. And he's holding alms. And if you've ever looked at Bible stories, you will actually see that those people that were so ashamed of begging, they would actually do this. They didn't want you looking at him because they were so ashamed. And as he's walking in, he said, "Alms, alms." It says that Peter looked down at him and said, "Look up to me." And he looked up to him and he said these words in chapter 3, verse 6. Then Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." I know I don't want to spoil the end of the story, but can I tell you what he did? He walked. He got up and he began to walk. And it says, in fact, later on that he is, well, the first thing we know is that it wasn't money. They didn't have any. And so you think to yourself, what can I give besides money? That's all I've got to give. You know what you give? You give of yourself. Because the disciples knew that the power that they had was not in the money. It was in the gift that God had given them. And when they began to tell people, "Hey, this is in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth," watch what happens. They were obedient. This is after the day of Pentecost. This is the first miracle that happens. So the first thing that we need to understand in giving generously is it's not just about money. Give of yourself. Do you have time that you can give to somebody else? Do you have a list of people that you can call? Do you have cards that you can send out? We know some of our ladies are wonderful card givers. Ladies, thank you for giving generously. I know it takes effort. I know that it takes money and resources. Thank you. Thank you for giving generously. All of us need to be giving of ourselves. But the second way that we need to give is found in Malachi chapter 3 and verse 10. It says this, "Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house. Prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open up the windows of heaven, pour out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it." You need to be faithful with your finances. This is going to be the hard one, because I know some of you struggle with the finance part of it. I know some of you say, "Pastor Tim, I'm just barely making it by the ends of the month. I don't know how we can give." Can I tell you, my friends, listen. I haven't talked to Missy about this. Missy, I'm sorry. I'll talk to you about it later. We had a form probably 6 or 7 years ago about a faith-giving promise where you promise to give faithfully for 3 months and we will put back that money. It'll be in our regular account, but if after 3 months God has not blessed you with being faithful in your tithes and offerings, and you come to us, now you have to show you've been faithful. You can't just say 1 week, "Oh, it's hard. I want my money back." We're not giving you your money back. You gave it to the church. But if you're faithful after 3 months, and you say, "Okay, I'm going to try this out." You try it out and you see that God has been faithful because you went out and you stepped out on faith. You say, "Pastor Tim, it really isn't working for me." You know what we'll do? We'll give you all your money back. It'll be like your tax refund. But you know what? I have no doubt but that God is going to bless you more than you ever thought possible. Amen again. Sister Diana's amen in me. Keep it up, Sister Diana. I need you over here on this. I'm going to start leaning over here so that I can get Sister Diana's amens. Give generously of yourself. Give generously of your finances. The third thing that we need to do, this will help us with those of you that have trouble with finances. Give purposefully. Give purposefully. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse the first part of 7 says this, "Every man according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity." Some of you say, Pastor Tim, I can't give the amount that other people are giving. I'm not asking you to give anything. I'm asking you to be faithful to God. Plan your giving. Plan your giving. Say, Pastor Tim, we struggle with planning. You need to start planning. Because if you don't plan today, you will not have anything tomorrow. I know how some of us live. I've lived this way before. My wife will tell you this. I hate it. She used to tell me all the time, sorry, honey. She used to tell me all the time, don't worry about it. God will provide it. I said, I believe that He will provide it. I just need to see how He's going to provide it. I need to understand. I know couples are looking at each other right now. Praise the Lord. See, I told you He was right. No, you told me He was wrong. I can't believe that you're even siding with Him. That's usually how it is. We have a saver and we have a giver. And they get married. And the wives are saying amen, or the husbands are saying, I'm going to be quiet. I'm not saying a word. Listen to me. I believe that God, from the beginning of time, God showed us the example because He was a planner. Amen, Pastor. When He created the worlds, He planned how to do it. When He created the sun, He planned how to do it. When He created the animals and the grass and the trees, He planned how to do it. My friends, when He created you, He planned how to do it. It says in Psalms, from my mother's womb, He ordained me. He planned me. John chapter 14 verse 2. Jesus is telling us about what's going to happen. It's right before He talks to His disciples and He looks at them and He says this. I know some of you are worried, but in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. Underline this. I go to prepare a place for you. You know what I'm going to say? I got to plan what we're going to give because it's going to be so much more than you ever thought possible. You are going to be amazed. It wasn't built yet. You know, He's been preparing it for 2,000 years. Man, what a house. Give purposefully. Some of you need to go home right. You need to go right off church. Don't do it now. Don't leave now. Everybody don't know where you're going. Stay here. And then after church, go home and say, let's write down our finances. I want to be faithful to God. I want a purpose. If we can only give $25 a week, let's do it. Let's plan it and see what God does with our finances. And let's even go a step further and say, if we can give $25 for a week, for 4 weeks, let's try and give 50 next month. And 100 and 200. And 400 and 800 and 1200. I'll keep going if you're not going to say amen. 1600, 3200. Yeah, thank you. I didn't know how far we were going to go up there. We stopped at 3,200. Amen. That's a week. That's not a month, everybody. There we go. Oh, now you wish you would have said something earlier. Give purposefully. In other words, plan what you're going to do with your life. Don't just come to the end and say, what do we have now? And by the way, that it doesn't just have to be with your finances. It can also be with your time. Plan what you do with your time. Fourth, we have give secretly, give generously, give purposefully. The fourth, give sacrificially. Give sacrificially. Jesus tells a story in Mark's gospel about how he's sitting in front of the place where they receive money for the temple. It says this, and Jesus said over against the treasury, "Behold how the people cast money into the treasury, and many that were rich cast in much. There came a certain poor widow. She threw in two mites, which make a farthing. And he called unto his disciples and saith unto them, Verily I say unto you, this poor widow hath cast more in than all they which have cast into the treasury. For all they did cast in was their abundance, but she of her want did cast in all that she had, even all her living." Sacrificially giving. I know we are a diverse congregation. We have some people that make minimum wage or a little bit above. I don't know if anybody makes, I'm sure there are people that make minimum wage, but in this day and age, it seems like everybody is above minimum wage now. Minimum wage, some make in the $20 range, $30 range, $50 range. Some, when they are working, even making in the $100 range per hour. No, I'm not going to tell you who it is. So to some people, $20 would be a lot. To others, $20 is a day at Starbucks. God wants to get a hold of you so much that when you begin to really understand who He is and what He wants to do for your life, you begin to know that it's better to give. I got in late. I'm going to tell on myself now. Got in late last night. Before we went on the trip, I went into my sock drawer. Yes, I have a sock drawer. Some of you don't have a sock drawer. Some of you have three socks that are on the dresser. I have a sock drawer. Now, let me just tell you, my sock drawer is this wide and about this deep. Now, I have to explain that there are some socks in there that still remember high school. Because you never know when you're going to need a sock. Amen, brothers? Until I was doing this sermon. And I thought, why do I have so many socks? Becky was sitting out there. I am in the thing. One of the socks, here it is. I'm just showing you. One of the socks, it was so full, one of the socks was missing. And I knew it was on top, so I knew it had been pulled around into the back. How many of you, some of your dressers are so packed full that you lose stuff in the back. This is my sock drawer. How many socks do I need? So I was actually going to take them today, bring them up for you to look at, and sell them for a dollar. And give all the money. And I forgot because I got in so late last night. By the way, if you need socks, come to me afterwards and we can make a deal. There are some times when we have so much stuff and we think to ourselves, you know, I need more stuff. Jesus looks at us and says, oh, I just got another idea. Jesus looks, why don't you give it to somebody that needs it? Have a giving spirit. See, that's what sacrificial giving is all about. It's getting to the place where not only you've planned it, not only you're generous with it, but now you're actually sacrificial with it. You give over and above, knowing that God will take care of you. Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 and 8 gives us the example of sacrificial giving. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, took upon him the form of the servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. You know what we call that? Sacrificial giving. Giving all. So many of us hold on to, I heard this story years and years ago. I think it's a wonderful story. I probably have told it, but I'll say I'm old enough to where I can now say I'll repeat it. Don't tell me if I've told it. Just listen to it. Church treasurer of a church resigned, and they couldn't find anybody because the finances were so tight at the church. Living paycheck to paycheck, week to week, they decided to go to the local grain operator. The manager there said he would consider it. After a week, he came back to them. He said, I will take the position on two conditions. First condition is that you will not ask for a treasurer's report for 1 year. Second condition, there will be no questions about the finances. You will not have to worry about the finances. All you have to do is be faithful, and God will take care of them. Halfway through the year, the people started wondering, how's it going? I wish we knew how the finances were going. He was not saying a word. Many of them used him as their grain operator, and so he knew that they knew that he was trusted because he was fair to them. So finally, at the conclusion of the year, at the annual business meeting, he got up and gave his treasurer's report. This is what it sounded like. The church indebtedness of $228,000 was paid off. The minister's salary was increased by 8%. Our giving to missions increased by 20%. There are no outstanding bills, and the balance in the checking account is $11,252. People were amazed. How did he do it? They questioned him. How did you do it? Where did you get all this money from? He looked at him, he said this, most of you come to my grain elevator with your grain. He said, every time you came, I just held back 10% and put it in the name, in your name at the church. And then he looked at them, he said, can you imagine what it would be like if we were faithful with what God gave us? Can I ask you a question? How is your giving today? Remember, I told you this is not just about finances. This is about your giving spirit, your giving attitude. I know some of you are saying, Pastor Tim, I want to be all in. If you want to be all in, you got to give all in. God just doesn't want an arm or a leg. Heard this quote, I thought it was good. Every time God receives somebody and they hand out their hands, He automatically gives them a free brain so they can begin to use it for God. Can I tell you, my friends, we need to be a giving people. Today I want to open up the altar. I know there are going to be some of you in the resistance. I'm going to give you three characteristics of people that should come. The first one, don't know how many will come because of this. I'm not going to ask. I'm just going to come up and pray with you. First one, if you're selfish, you're one of those guys and girls that holds on to the money. You need to have that safety boat. You need to have that tightness of that full sock drawer. Might be time for you to say, God, I'm ready. I want to become a giver. I want to be a person that gives more than receives. Second one is this. Second type of person is this. I don't have anything left to give. To you, I would say you need to come because God can give you a fresh touch. I can tell some of you are tired. Some of you work hard at long hours. Some of you are under a lot of stress. Can I tell you that God can give you a fresh touch? There might be a third. These are the people that are actually hurting. You're hurting in your life. You're not even looking about giving. Can I tell you, my friends, that God can give you grace to make it through? God can give you strength to withstand the storms. 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 7 says this, casting all our cares upon Him, for He cares for us. If you're hurting today, maybe it's time for you to come up and say, God, I'm hurting so much. I need to give it to You. I need to cast my care upon You because You told me that You would never, never leave me or forsake me. I'm going to ask our musicians and song leader to come forward at this time. If we could be standing. I want to thank you so much for coming today, but folks, we're not done yet. Let God still work. God's still wanting to work in your life. God is still wanting to move in our midst. God is still wanting people to take that step to be all in. And that giving attitude, that attitude of I want to give like Jesus gave, needs to be a part of our life. Heavenly Father, as we come to You this morning, we thank You so much, Lord. And we just pray right now for Your Holy Spirit to come and move in our midst as He already has. Father, right now, if there are those that are hurting, if there are those who are in financial problems, if there are those that are stingy, Lord, I pray right now that You would just stir their hearts and help them to see that Your way is best. John 3:16 tells us that You gave Your only Son. So today we want to give ourselves to You. Lord, thank You for helping us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. What shall we sing, Brother David?
Page 486.
486, if God has spoken to your heart, don't be afraid, folks. This is a place where we can meet God. 486. Nobody looking around, anybody across the congregation, just want to raise your hand and say, Pastor Tim, pray for me. Pray for me, Pastor Tim, I have a need. Anybody across the congregation, nobody's looking around, this is just between me and you. Folks, I delivered my heart. I love y'all. I want you to know the wonderful, wonderful grace that God gives you when you begin to live true, honest, holy, all-in lives. It will change you. There's some things that you folks struggle with. I understand that. But there needs to come a place where you finally say, okay, God, I'm done. I fight. And I know that I've got this wrong attitude in me, but I struggle with it. I'm going to pray for you this week. I'm going to pray that God's going to help you. And no, I don't have anybody in mind. I just know people. I know how we are. And I believe some of you probably are even embarrassed. Say, if I raise my hand, he knows exactly why I'm raising my hand. Don't forget about this evening service, folks. Don't forget about Wednesday night. Heavenly Father, as we come to you this morning, we want to just first of all acknowledge that we thank you. We thank you that you are such a giving God. You give us things and you bless us with things. And the country that we live in is such a blessed country. Seems like we are more blessed than anybody. We believe it's because we have put you first for many, many years, but it's rapidly changing. And so we pray right now, Lord, that we will not forget the place that you need to be, and that's right in the center of our eyes, looking to you, the author and the finisher of our faith, that you might be able to supply and meet all our needs according to your riches and glory. Come with us to our homes. And let us begin to search on how we can be better givers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much. God bless you. Appreciate you all. Don't forget to come back. If you want to shake my hand, you can. I know probably none of you are going to. But I'll extend.